Thanks again, Jack, for stepping in at such short notice. This diarrhoea bug's sweeping right through the cast. Literally, they're shitting like cows in an abattoir. Here, I've put you in dressing room number one, next to the girl dancers, because I thought you'd like that.
Thanks, Dave. How long do you need?
7 minutes first half, 12 minutes second.
Is that all?
Yeah, easy one tonight. Loads of action.
I am topping it, though, aren't I?
Of course you are. You're closing both halves. Yeah. Anyway, mind your head as you go in. They're fixing the pipes. We're having trouble with the waterworks.
Thanks, Dave.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and welcome your host and compere for the evening, Mr. Dave, you gotta love me, Chambers! Good evening! Oh, now you can do better than that. I said good evening! Good evening, all the rich people! Bloody show-offs. Good evening, all the poor people! That's better, my kind of audience. Let's all get to know each other. I want everyone to turn to the person on their right and say in their poshest voice, hello, how do you do? That's very posh, very posh. It's never been so posh in here. Now I want you to turn to the person on your left and say, mind your own business. Bloody hell, they meant that. Now I want you to turn to the person you like the best and give them a great big sloppy wet kiss. Ooh. Hold up, there's two blokes at the back there kissing, eh? Well, there's a lot of it about. I read in the paper that one in every four men is that way. So if you're sitting with three of your mates and they're all right, it's you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, as many of you know, this is our last week here at the Palace. And I've got a great show lined up for you. I've got three guest speakers for you this evening. First of all, I've got a fella from the Channel Islands. He's going to be talking all about channels. Then I've got a fella from the Canary Islands, he's going to be talking all about canaries. Following that, we've got a bloke from the Virgin Islands. He's just going to talk about the first thing that comes up. After that, we've got an internationally famous one-legged tap dancer called Klopp. He will be dancing to Knee Up Mother Brown. It doesn't last long, but he goes down well. Now, due to unforeseen circumstances, our top of the bill cannot be with us here this evening, but I have booked a fabulous replacement. You will have seen him on your TV screens as part of Granada Television's Comedians. It's the one and only Mr. Jack Wilfreds. But without any further ado, it's on with the show. I'd like to now introduce you to our resident dancers. Now, these girls are bound to get your pulses racing, so please put your hands together and welcome on stage, Heart Attack! I'm just a love machine.
Got a big head then. Using my second spot now gives me a chance to tell the punters about my life story.
So they can tell that you're a lying, cheating thief of bad gags from a shitty Polaroid, can't it?
It's always going to look blurry through your eyes, Sid. Anyway, how long has it been? 10? 11 years?
It's been 10 years, 11 months, and 3 days.
Oh, yeah. How is Julie?
Don't you mention her name.
Does this bloody thing work or not?
It's not worked for years.
It's not the only thing around here then, is it?
So we've started that way.
You started it?
Piss off.
Sid, you're 50, not 5.
We need it open to hear the cues.
I've got on for 40 minutes.
And I'm on in 10.
How the mighty have fallen. Here she is. Miss Whitbread, 1976.
You know him second.
Yeah, but you should have won it, because that cow Wendy was nowhere near as pretty as you.
Ah, they're lovely. What am I supposed to do with them?
We'll just put him in the sink for now. No one's going to use it.
Flattery and flowers. Gonna get you everywhere tonight. I'm feeling frisky, yummy, feeling excited. Come say hi to Tracy. I've told her all about
it. Not yet. Not yet. Let me sort my gags out. Let me sort my suits out. I'll be in a bit. Which Tracy is it? Tracy Davies or Tracy Jones?
Neither, pet. New girl, Tracy Cox. With an X.
Some things never bloody change, do they? Jack of all maids, master of none, that's what we used to call you. Because you never spent more than 5 minutes with them before you ruined the bloody lot of them.
Hold on, Don Juan. I learnt it all from you. Just because they don't want anything to do with you anymore.
And I don't want anything to do with you. I grew up.
Well, Sid, she may not be the brightest button in the box, but as we all know, dancers cannot resist a good comic.
Good comic? What the bloody hell she do with you then?
Well, 10 million people on a Friday night can't be wrong, can they? And for your information, we've been together 2 years, 4 months, and 3 days. She's special.
In about 7 minutes, Louis. Just put the duo on. He's old enough to be her dad, and she's stone deaf, but they're cheap. Should have gone with those two from behind the bar. Here, I've got a new one for you, Jack. What's the definition of mixed emotions?
I've no idea.
Your mother-in-law driving off a cliff in your new car. Didn't have that one, Jack. Right.
Thanks, Dave. You know what? I'll put it in my book.
May as well have your gags, David, as everybody else's. You may as well do yours as well.
Give it a rest, Sid. It's getting boring now.
I take it you two know each other, then.
Yeah, we've got a bit of history. We did the same camps together, and up until I did a bit of telly, we did a few of the same clubs and theatres.
You did the holiday camps?
Yeah, and he did. But by the time I'd arrived for my first season as a blue coat, he finished and he became the camp comic. He went on to become the best comic in the country, Dave. I learned everything I know from him. But don't tell him that. I like him to think I wasn't listening. Here he is now. I was just telling Dave about my first season on the holiday camp. Happy days. Probably the happiest days of my life.
They were great.
And Susie started off there too.
Yeah, but 20 years later.
It wasn't 20 years, Sid. Hold on, I'll ask him. Susie! Susie! Oh, there you are. Susie. When were you at Preston?
69
Street from
school.
You see, there's only 16 years between us.
Ooh, that makes it all right then.
Well, hold on, Sid. There's 10 years between you and Julie. And you weren't moaning then. Besides, every man alive wants a younger girl. I guarantee every man in that auditorium tonight, if they're sat there with their wives or sat there with their girlfriends, or if they're lucky both, guarantee at some point they're going to fantasize about spending the night with Susie or Tracy or one of the other dancers. It's human nature. You don't see too many 4-year-old women with their tits out in the sun.
I saw a 6-year-old bird with her tits out on the beach today.
The newspaper day. The Sun newspaper.
Come on, Louis, it's no longer an older man. Besides, he's not taught us anything I haven't already learned at the camps.
What? Nothing.
Nothing they need to know anyway.
We all know the unwritten rule, don't we? What goes on the road stays on the road, and what happens when you're on any camp stays in the camps.
Exactly, David.
So, come on, Louis, you must have some stories to tell from when you were younger.
Well, none that I'm going to tell you, David, my boy.
Oh, come on, Louis, we've worked together all summer and I don't even know that much about you.
Really? Well, all right then. Like most entertainers, some of them really famous now. I started off as a blue coat. Wasn't a blue coat by the time he got there, though. No. By that time, I'd risen to the dizzy heights of the camp comic. There's a difference, you know. Even had my own room, the Clwyd bar. Notorious on the North Wales coast. We had everybody who was anybody there then. But to answer your question, David, yes, a good time was had by all. Isn't that right, Casanova?
Casanova?
Oh, come on, love. You know what the camps were like, and it was a few years ago. Besides, he can't talk. He's been laid on more chalet floors than Lionel. Tell him about the grass.
Bugger off.
Oh, no, you've got it now.
Yeah, come on, Louis, what's the grass?
I'm not telling you lot how I lost my cherry.
Oh, now we're talking.
And guys, seriously, listen to this, because this will be the first time he's been funny in years.
Well, I was a young 17-year-old Torag from the north of England. Believe it or not, love, I was then pure as the driven snow. Left the love of my life back home, promising a safe return to her loving arms. That wasn't until I put on the coat or the jacket of love. This my mate used to call it. Never really understood what he meant by that until that fateful night when a young 19-year-old buxom lass asked me back to her chalet for coffee.
Did you do it then, Louis?
Well, I thought I did, Dave, yeah. But it turns out I was just putting it in the grass.
So you chafed your knees then? That's happened to me a lot.
You what?
Outside in the grass.
Not that grass. Oh, grass.
Yeah, instead of being in the tunnel of love, I was just rubbing against the fringe of nature.
So instead of planting the seed, he was just mowing the lawn.
Didn't.
Well, how did you know you weren't doing it then?
Because the next night, Gary, my boy, we had round two. And I said to him, do you not think we ought to take precautions? And she said, you can't get much safer than last night. You weren't even in the station.
Well, at least you didn't have to worry about pulling out on time.
Hey, she was giving me all the right signals.
And he's back.
And I thank you.
Louis, that's brilliant.
What about you then, Sue?
Don't you dare tell them, Susie. The lady doesn't tell, Dave. Wasn't me though, boys, unfortunately.
I've lost count how many times I've lost my virginity. What about you, Pat?
Really?
You want to know mine? I'll tell you one day, but not now. It was the biggest disaster of my life.
Oh, come on, Louis Stolz is yours, can't be not Pat.
Don't you bet on it, young lady. It makes mine read like a fairy tale.
Yeah, grim. For a start, I looked a little bit like this.
I've not seen that one before.
If I'd have shown you this one before, Susie, you wouldn't still be seeing me. Obviously different now. That was the virgin years. And this is my brand new publicity shot. Also use it as my passport photo.
Yeah, it looks like somebody stamped on your face.
And that's why she's a dancer. Come on then, Jack, how comes your first time was so bad?
Well, I'll tell you, Dave, it was a Friday night. It was my first season as a Blue, and on a Friday night we was always told to dance with the guests, and I was dancing with this one family, and their daughter kept on staring at me. And it obviously unsettled me, because as you can see, I wasn't as good-looking then as I am now.
Hey, you watch the time, Dave.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I've got to go get changed with me.
Put yeah, come on, get out of here.
Finish it later, Jack.
I've got to get coming out Tracy in a minute. You're still on it then, Sid?
Got bugger all to do with you. Anyway, they don't know who Sid is round here, so it's Louis if you don't mind.
Whatever you want. I'll get out your hair. What's left of it? Gonna go meet Tracy.
Got your props, Louis. I'll set them on the stage for you.
Yeah.
It must be nice working with Jack again.
Not really.
Ooh. Yeah. You all right, Louis?
Yeah, I'm fine, yeah. Just don't drop that, yeah.
As if I would. So, you two do the same club circuit together, then?
He's been blabbing his big mouth off again, has he?
He ain't said much.
He wouldn't, would he? Wasn't top of the bill then, was he?
Who was then?
I don't know, Dave. Some bloke, he wouldn't know him. Anyway, how many's in tonight?
Oh, about 110.
Not bad, yeah. Wow. Wow. What do you think of Tracy then?
Well, the kids ain't gonna go angry when she has them, are they?
Dave seen him.
Have you?
Yeah.
One popped out last night, Dave ran on. He had to pop it back in again.
Well, I didn't have to, but I do like to help the damsel in distress.
Well, Dave. Distress or that dress, you still want to see him.
Hey, you behave, that's his target for the summer.
All right, Sid. Told you, I've changed. I'm happy with Susie. Anyway, how are you getting on with him?
Well, there's a couple of things in the way.
You can say that again.
But I'm working my way round him.
Dave, hope they stay in tonight.
I bloody don't.
Behave!
All right, you, Sid. Have you been behaving?
10 years, 11 months and 3 days.
Yeah, but... who's counting?
So, Tell me then, Jack, whose gags are you doing tonight then?
Does it matter to you nowadays? Or are you going to go on stage and do my whole routine in mine before I go on?
Maybe.
Thanks,
love. Right. Let's do this.
Two's company, ladies and gentlemen, our fabulous duo. And what about our girl dancers? Aren't they really good and very, very versatile? You see, on the one hand, with the right leg, they can do tap dance. With the left leg, they can do ballet. And between the two, they make a very good living. And I have been flirting with those girls because I've got the dressing room next door to them, yes. And there's a little hole in the wall. I discovered a hole in the dressing room wall. I did report it to the manager. He said he'd look into it for me. Actually, it's quite a big hole. You can see right through. You can see everything. I was going to cover it up, but I thought, what the heck? Let them look. You've got to love me. I think those girls fancy me. I was in the dressing room the other day, and one of the girls came in. It was Tracy. You know Tracy, the one with the big personalities. She came in and she said to me, Dave, take off my blouse. So I did. She said, Dave, take off my skirt. So I did. She said, Dave, take off my bra. So I did. She said, Dave, take off my panties. So I did. She said, Dave, don't ever let me catch you wearing my clothes again. Everyone needs a hobby, I'll tell you that. But don't say anything about that. And speaking of which, now, to entertain you and put a smile on your face without saying a word, please put your hands together for international mime artist, Mr. Louis LeBlue.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, your hands together for the one and only Mr. Louis LeBlue!
Get him on!
Susie! Susie! How was it?
Alright.
Are they nice?
Alright.
How many did?
About 100?
It's not bad in this heat wave. To be honest with you, it's so hot at the moment, I'm not even sleeping with a sheet on.
Makes a change for you, doesn't it, Jack? You should sleep with an hard on.
Sid, I never sleep with hard on. Look, are we ever going to move on? Let bygones be bygones? I was young. I was naive.
You weren't young, Jack.
I was younger than you, and we all did it.
Yeah, but some of us didn't do it with our best friend's wife. No amount of apologies is going to put that right. So let's just do this, shall we? Won't cause a scene in front of this lot. Might even crack a few gags. But don't think for 1 minute this is over, Jack. You were a shit then, and you're an even bigger shit now.
Just stick this here for a minute, Louis.
But Dave, don't go away. Jack here is very kindly just snipping off to the back bar, aren't you? Get us both a drink, yeah? We'll have two double whiskies.
Oh, no, 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 I don't drink whiskey.
They're for me, Dave, not you. Anyway, what do you want?
I'll have half a mile, if that's okay, Jack.
All right, Dave, I'll get you a drink.
Cheers. Thanks again, Jack. Yeah, I better go and take them girl dancers off. I'll tell you what, there's not many chocolate bills decent enough to do that.
No! You're right there, David, my boy. There is a distinct lack of decency. Just slip into the office, Dave. I'll be back in 5.
Now yours was half a mile. Oh, sorry, love, I didn't get you one.
That's all right. How about you give us one now?
What, in here?
It's not like we're going to be long, is it?
Rock. Along the promenade I stroll,
It may be sticky, but I never complain. It's nice to have a nibble at it now and again. Every day, wherever I stray, the kids all round me flock. One afternoon, the band conductor up on his stand somehow lost his bat and it flew out of his hand. So I jumped in his place and then conducted the band with me little stick of Blackpool rock. With me little stick of Blackpool rock. Turned out nice again, ladies and gentlemen. And now it's time to bring you your top of the bill from this evening. So please put your hands together and give a warm welcome to television comedian Jack Wilfrids.
And please keep the applause going for your wonderful host on this evening's theatre show, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Dave Chambers. Thank you, David, and it is wonderful to be here. As you know, I am a late replacement, ladies and gentlemen. I had to get the train up here after I had the phone call this afternoon. I was on the train. While I was on the train, there was a lady sat opposite me. She was no older than 25. She was beautiful, but she had a badge on her chest that said Nan. I said, "You're too young to be a Nan." She said, "I'm not a Nan." I said, "Well, why has it got Nan on your badge?" She said, "That stands for the National Association of Nymphomaniacs." She said, "I'm on the way to a convention. We do lots of studies." And I said, "Well, what have you found out so far?" She said, "Red Indians are the greatest lovers, and the Jewish men last the longest." She said, "By the way, my name is Mary." I said, "Hello, Mary. I'm Tonto Goldberg." Now, listen. Now, I want to tell you a little story, ladies and gentlemen, about little Johnny from Chorley. It was his teacher's birthday, and he wanted to get her a present. So we took her this box, and there was a little bit of fluid dripping from the box, and she tasted it. "Oh," she said, "Johnny, is this lager?" He said, "No, it's not lager, miss." She tasted it. She said, "Is it cider?" He said, "No, miss, it's not cider." "Oh," she said, "I can't guess what I've got for my birthday. What is it, Johnny?" He said, "It's a puppy." And little Johnny had to go to the doctor's because his mother was worried about the size of his little thingy, you see. The doctor said, "There's nothing wrong with it, but if you want it to grow nice and big, feed him lots of toast." The following morning, Johnny woke up, there was 36 rounds of toast on the breakfast table. He turned to his mum, he said, "Mum, I can't eat all that toast." She said, "The top one's for you, the rest is for your father." Now, I would like to tell the story about three couples who go up to the gates of heaven. And St. Peter said to the first couple, "You can't come in." The man said, "Why not?" And St. Peter said, "Because you, sir, all your life were governed by alcohol. Alcohol ruled your entire existence on earth. You even married a woman called Sherry." Off you go. "Your wife's called Sherry as well, I take it, sir." Said to the second couple, "You can't come in either." And the man said, "Why not?" He said, "Because you, sir, all your life were governed by money. Money ruled your entire existence on earth. You even married a woman called Penny." Off you go. The third husband looked at his wife. He said, "You know what, Fanny? We're not going to get in here tonight. Anyway, you can clap at that if you want to, ladies and gentlemen. You can clap at that if you want to. This isn't the television now. This is a live theatre show. This is a live theatre show, and you need to pay attention to the stories because this is a story about three brothers, Tom, Dick and Harry. And Tom and Harry have got size 10 feet, and their brother Dick has got size 14 feet. Extraordinary. The three boys were going to a dance one night, but Dick was not feeling very well, so he stayed at home. And Tom and Harry were dancing with these girls, and the girl said to Tom and Harry, "Haven't you boys got big feet?" They said, "You think we've got big feet? You should see our dicks." Now, I'll do another one. Now, listen. Did that one on the telly last week as well, I can tell you. There's a lovely story about little Johnny walking down the street, and the vicar stopped him. He said, "Good morning, Johnny." And little Johnny said, "Good morning, vicar." He said, "Johnny, you're talking with a Pakistani accent. Is your father Pakistani?" He said, "No, my father is not Pakistani." He said, "Is your mother Pakistani?" He said, "No, my mother is not Pakistani." He said, "All your friends Pakistani?" He said, "No, my friends are not Pakistani." And the vicar said, "Well, why are you talking with a Pakistani accent?" And little Johnny said, "My English teacher is Pakistani." Now, ladies and gentlemen, before I go, I would like to tell a true story about a good friend of mine called Mac. I've known him for years, and I've only ever known him by the name of Mac. And I said, "Mac, you must tell me a little bit more about yourself." He said, "Well, Jack, my real name is John Thomas McDangle. And I went to college to study art, and I took a degree, and I passed with honours. I became a Bachelor of the Arts. I was then known as John Thomas McDangle, B.A. With my knowledge of art, I was asked to paint the ceiling of a local church. While painting the ceiling of the church, I got interested in how the church works, and I studied theology. Again, I took a degree. Again, I passed with honours. I became a doctor of theology. I was known as John Thomas McDangle, B.A.D.T. With my knowledge of theology, I went to Africa to teach the natives the missionary way. And while in Africa, I taught a native girl the missionary way. I was known as John Thomas McDangle, B-A-D-T-V-D. I had to come back to be cured of the VD, and the church found out about me being with the native girl, and they took away my DT. I was known as John Thomas McDangle, B-A-V-D. The church told the College of Art, and they took away my BA. I was known as John Thomas McDangle, VD. The VD took away me, John Thomas. I've nothing left to dangle. My friends call me Mac. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll see you in the second half. I'll see you in the second half.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, your applause once again for our top of the bill, Mr. Jack Wilfreds. Ladies and gentlemen, there will now be a 15-minute intermission to give you a chance to take in the sea air, have a smoke, grab a drink from the bar, or buy an ice cream from one of our beautiful usherettes for only 5 bob. That is, if you have 5 bob in old money. If not, they're 2 quid. You've got to love me, haven't you? See you in part 2.
Tommy Cooper gets him in second.
Well, since I've done a bit of telly, I get him a lot quicker than I used to. It's amazing what a few minutes on the box can do, Sid. That TV's the future. If you're on it. Why is that funny? You had it good. You just let it slip.
And don't you bloody enjoy reminding me. Telly will make you. But don't be surprised if it comes back to break you and all your cheap jibes at anybody who's not, well, you.
What's that supposed to mean?
You! You're an arrogant, obnoxious, bigoted, prejudiced prick.
I'm not prejudiced.
You! Not prejudiced!
Don't poke your fingers in.
I know what you've been doing in the clubs. Laying into the minorities.
Laying into them? They're coming over here in their droves, taking our jobs, taking our houses, and who's going to pay to look after them when they're ill? We will.
Every man alive has the right to make a better life for himself. Even you would take yourself halfway around the world to make a better life for you and your family. Well, that's if you had one.
If I had one. You were the closest thing I had to family, Sid. And you left me. And then you started spreading bullshit and you tried to destroy my career. Well, I beat you and I beat those bastards trying to take over my country.
And you say you're not prejudiced.
Fuck off! I own a colour telly, what more do you want?
I don't want anything from you, Jack. Not now. Not ever. Yeah. I'm just saying, that you're going to cock up big time if you think this lot's going to last forever. I can't wait for the day that I sit back in silence watching the great Jack Wilfrid playing Bamber Bridge Band Club for 15 quid after the bingo's finished. You know what? That'll be the best gig you get that week. Your material. Look at it. It's older than Max Miller. You're not clever like your so-called heroes, Bob and Barry. Don't write any of your own material. Just like a live version of Alf Garnett bringing all your gripes and your anger to the paying public.
Paying public agree with me, Sid. Why should these people come over here buying up all our businesses? That's why they don't play football. Because every time they get a corner, they build a shop on it.
And I rest my case.
So you're okay with it, are you? You're okay with Tommy playing in the street with these people?
Just listen to yourself, Jack. Who made you, Lord God of bloody mighty? At least I can picture a time where Tommy can play in the street with people from different backgrounds without being the butt of some jumped up comics gag.
When are you going to wake up, Sid? They are third world people living in a first world country. You wouldn't put a lion and a donkey in the same pen, would you?
A lion and a donkey. One a natural born leader, full of courage, and the other one an ass. And we all know which one you are.
Oh, I'm just saying, Sid. I really, honestly, have not got a prejudiced bone in my body. They just shouldn't be allowed in.
So you're all rah, rah, rah for St. George, eh?
Of course I am. He's what made Great Britain great.
Well, I hate to piss on your bonfire, but I think you'll find St. George is actually a Turkish immigrant. And you're saying that he's what made Great Britain great, and in the next breath, you're saying he shouldn't be allowed in. God Almighty, Hitler and Enoch Powell in the space of 5 minutes should give him your own TV show doing impressions, not comedy. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the great Jack Wilfrid, man of a thousand faces, doing his impersonation of our very first Nazi Pope. Bloody hell, Jack! When did you get so fucking messed up?
I wish I was Enoch Powell. I'd make this country a lot better place to live. Anyway, the minorities have always been the whipping boys for comics gags. The Irish never complain.
Just saying that your kind of comedy can't last. Morecambe and Wise, they're the only ones who last.
You've not heard of the two Ronnies then?
I'll give you that. I'll give you that. Two Ronnies, yeah, it's timeless.
Benny Hill?
No chance.
You've lost your marbles.
You're not thinking straight, Jack. Life goes full circle. Always has done, always will do.
Well,
women's lib, they won't swallow it.
Anyone who's a member of women's lib won't swallow anything. We can't just pussyfoot around these people, though, Sid. Comedy's comedy, just the way it is.
And I'm just saying that your kind of comedy won't last.
Well, Benny Hill's clever than people give him credit for. He writes his own gags, he writes his own songs.
Semi-naked women running round after a fat 50-year-old bloke is wrong.
Well, then we're both fucked. Listen.
You've just got to let that young girl live her life, Jack.
It's easier said than done, Sid. I don't think I'll ever be with anyone my own age.
Doesn't have to be your own age, Jack. Just a few years older would be good. Otherwise, you're going to end up like those radio DJs and TV celebrities, shagging all the groupies. We all know what's going on there. And believe me, that'll come back and bite them on the arse one day.
You're worried about Penny Hill.
Sorry, Dad.
Oh, no, 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 no! David, my boy. Come in here. Stick up for an old crow, would you?
Well, I was going to come in sooner, but I didn't want to interrupt the argument.
That wasn't an argument, Dave. That was another lecture. Sid has always been good at running other people's lives.
I think everyone's a bit like that, Jack. My dad used to run my mum's life through the accident.
Accident? What happened?
She shot him.
Now that is more like it, David, my boy. Something funny and original.
No, Louis. She really shot him. You've got to love me, haven't you? I can't go in there tonight, but you can have a fun, Jack.
I'll pull that one.
Anyway, I am original. I've given you loads of gags.
Go on then, David. Give us one right now. One you've written yourself.
All right, here's one then. I went to the clairvoyant yesterday. She told me I'm never going to have any children. Then the crystal ball
rolled off the table and crushed your knackers.
Very good, very good. You can have that one. Here's another one then. I was riding over my bicycle yesterday when I saw a pretty girl at the bus stop. I said to her, would you like a lift on my crossbar?
And she said, I'm not wearing any knickers. And you said, and this bike hasn't got a bloody crossbar.
Someone's in the mood, aren't they? Anyway, that's one of my best ones, and you can have that, so you should feel honoured.
Oh, thank you, David. Yeah, what would I have done this summer without you?
Come on, you miserable old git, we're off.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's audience participation time. So I want you all to participate with each other. And anybody not joining in, I shall come down there and interfere with you. So, ladies and gentlemen, do you fancy a sing-along?
Yeah.
I'll try that again, shall I? I said, do you fancy a sing-along?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Well, you start. If I know it, I'll join in. Now, it's easier than that. We're going to sing a song, ladies and gentlemen, that was made famous 4 years ago, 1972. It topped the charts. It was Chuck Berry's only number one to date, and our very own Mary Whitehouse tried to have it banned because she thought it was a little bit rude. I am, of course, talking about My Ding-a-Ling. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to get you to sing the chorus of My Ding-a-Ling. It's ever so easy. I've put the chorus in between the verses, so you can't miss it. And we're going to have a little bit of a practice. I'm going to sing it through once, and then we'll get you to all have a practice together. So it goes like this. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. That's all there is to it. So it's my ding-a-ling, I want you to play with my ding-a-ling, and you repeat that through. And now it's your turn. So everybody take a deep breath. Hold it for 45 minutes. Everybody! My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. It weren't bad, but I still don't think everybody was doing it. So we're going to have to do it again. And we're going to keep on doing it till everybody joins in. 2.5 hours last night. I've locked the doors. And remember, if I see you not doing it, I'll get you up here to do it all on your own. And if it makes it easier, stamp your feet and clap your hands at the same time. Here we go, everybody. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. That's very, very good. Very, very good. Eh? Best we've had it all night. I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to go right through the song, and I want you to get louder and louder and make more noise as we go. So here we go, ladies and gentlemen, as I tell you the story of My Ding-a-Ling. When I was a little bitty boy, my grandmother bought me a cute little toy. Silver bells hanging on a string, she told me it was my ding-a-ling-a-ling. Your turn, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. Mama took me to grammar school, I stopped off in a vestibule. Every time that bell would ring, catch me playing with my ding-a-ling-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. Once while climbing the garden wall, I slipped and had a terrible fall. I fell so hard I heard bells ring, but I held on to my ding-a-ling-a-ling. Your turn!
My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling.
My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. Once while swimming across Turtle Creek, man, no snappers all around my feet. Sure was hard swimming across that thing, with both hands holding my ding-a-ling-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. Now this here song, it ain't so sad, the cutest little song that you've ever had. And those of you who will not sing, you must be playing with your own ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. Ladies and gentlemen, please keep that applause going as I introduce you for the second time this evening to the one and only Mr. Louis LeBlue.
Of a jumped up prick. He taught me things. Of course he did. He was the best. And you learn from the best. Even when they don't want you to, you still learn. He had it good. He just let it slip. He took his eye off the ball. He expected the phone to ring. But it didn't ring because he didn't fucking make it ring. I've worked hard for this. I started playing proper writers, like Monkhouse and Crime. Monkhouse is a true pro. I lost count of the amount of gags he's written for me now. Cry's a great throw as well. All his gags, worth every single penny. He was top of his game for over a decade. So why didn't he pay to stay there? If you want to stay at the top in this business, you pay to stay at the top. You can't tell me he's happy because he took the moral high ground. Fuck the moral high ground. If you want to stay at the top, you've got to pay to stay at the top. You can't tell me that Des O'Connor writes his own gags. Not an arse, like he makes out. I'm just passionate. I'm passionate about life. I'm passionate about the business. I'm passionate about Susie. Because this entertainment, it's ever so lonely on the road. It's like a disease. You're traveling every single day of the year, all over the country, living out of a suitcase, listening to the sound of your own voice. It's like a disease. And the loneliness, it could take hold of you. It could kill you. If I married Susie, I wouldn't have to be lonely. She's already said she'll marry me. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to marry Susie. People will still remember me. That's all I really want. I just want people to know who I am. I just want people to remember my name.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear your applause once again for the one and only Mr. Louis LeBlue.
You keep drinking that fast, Sid. Come through, Dave. You ain't even gonna be able to fucking lie.
That's a bit uncalled for, isn't it?
Wonders why I hate him dead. His life should be mine. I'm a better stand-up comic than he'll ever be. I taught him, for Christ's sake. Oh, sorry.
Didn't know you were religious, Louis?
Never used to be. But I do like to go to the big man's house every now and again.
You going tomorrow?
I can't, it's shut.
Shut? Yeah, so that Lord Jesus Christ doesn't shut on a Sunday.
No, but the fish and chip shop does. And I like to eat a bit of fish after I've said my prayers. But he's never eaten his dinners off a piece of greasy paper. 10 years ago, I was the hungry one. Travelling up and down the country, trying out new routines, writing, practising, dreaming, and ultimately sacrificing the one thing that was ironically handed to me on a plate. Julie. It's no wonder she strayed. I was never there, and when I wasn't. Do you understand?
Think so?
She was right there next to me, David. And I never noticed her. If you do anything in this life, David, my boy, try and make a difference to your own. That way you'll make a difference to everybody who comes into contact with you. They'll feel better for having known you. And that way, you won't end up like a cantankerous old git like me. I gave up. And I shouldn't. Blame him. Shouldn't. Don't you tell him I said that, though. I like him thinking it's his fault. Anyway, I'm going for a posh piss.
What's a posh piss? I'm
going to do it in the bar.
Not the happiest bloke in the world tonight, is he?
Sid's glass will always be half empty, Dave.
Yeah, that's true.
Hey, Dave, why don't you see if Tracy Cox with an X wants to come out for something to eat later on? I'm taking Susie out, I'm starving, I've had that to eat all day.
Looks like you'll be getting plenty later though, doesn't it, eh?
We're going to go for a walk on the pier first, though. We're going to drop a message in a bottle into the water.
I did that years ago with my first wife. We were there at the end of the pier, wife in one hand, bottle in the other. Trouble is, I threw the wrong one in.
Dave, did anyone find the message?
What do you mean? I threw the wife in. Trouble is, the silly cow floated back to the beach.
Was she dead?
Nah, unfortunately not. Did you remember that scene in Dr. No, where Ursula Andrews had out the water? Well, when my wife came out the water, everyone started shouting, though. Three blokes tried to push her back in, and I was one of them, eh? You can put that one in your book,
Jim. Yeah, I will do, Dave. I rise at six and I feed the chicks, I'm feeling lonesome and blue. And when I milk the cow, it seems somehow my thoughts keep straying to you. As the horse and I plough the field nearby, your memory I can't erase. For as I walk at the rear of the horse, my dear, I seem to see your face. The committee have decided! Thought it was too good to be true.
You what?
Said at the end of the show, what do we do?
Dave brings us on one last time for the walk down and then I'm off to the pub.
Is that what drives you now, Sydney, is it? What you love?
Don't you fucking talk to me about love. You wouldn't know love. You bloody fell over it!
I get the love thing, Sid. I'm just not deluded enough to know that for the majority, that's not everyone.
I know what a fucking majority is!
You can't listen to anyone else, can you, for 5 minutes without hearing the sound of your own voice. Why the fuck did you become a mime?
Because you. You! Rendered me speechless.
Do you not think, Sid, that you may have done that to yourself? When you spent 12 months of the year on the road for nearly a decade, and when you did go home, you didn't even take a bunch of flowers for her. And she was waiting for you, Sid. And don't you dare tell me that you were faithful on the road, because we all know the unwritten rule of show business. What happens on the road stays on the road. And each and every single one of us are as guilty as the rest. Being an entertainer just makes it easy. Easy. Do you know what I mean? And there's loads of women out there as well, Sid. All prepared to join in. Spread their legs. So they can brag to their friends who they spent the night with. Just a fact, Sid. Celebrities fuck wannabes. Groupies fuck pop stars. And luckily for me, dancers fuck comics.
So earlier, when you said she's different, do you intend cheating on her as well then?
No one sets out to cheat, Sid. It just happens. But this is one life and one life only. Who is to judge another person by saying what is right or wrong?
The urges should stop when you're married.
Why do you think I never got married? For Christ's sake, Sid, that's where you and other people cock up. You expect everyone else to be perfect, to never let you down, to never make a mistake. But life isn't like that, Sid. And if you took just one look at your own life, you wouldn't be so quick to judge and blame others. What was it your great JC said? Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. Isn't that ironic? From one of the world's greatest sinners?
Ex-sinners. There you go, Jack. Why don't you have some Blackpool rock? The thing about rock is, my friend, it's a bit like life. I think the pleasure it's going to give you is going to last forever. And then one day, you've sucked it dry.
Hark at Father LeBlue, the man who thinks that Jack Daniels, Jim Beam and Johnny Walker is the holy bloody trinity. Next you'll be standing on top of the Blackpool Tower, turning your ice cream soda into wine and feeding the Saturday matinee audience with little Johnny from Chorley's fish paste sandwiches.
There's nothing wrong with trying to fix things that you've broken. The thing is, I realised I broke them in the first place.
And you realise this when, Sid?
What do you mean, when?
Well, you talk a good game, but you don't really care about people, do you? What are the name of those two kids behind the bar? You've been here 7 nights a week for 2 months. What are they called?
What do you mean?
Their names, Sid. It's not Sodding Mastermind.
Pass.
Exactly. You haven't even taken the time to care about people who make this show, make this theatre, this town what it is.
Go on then. What are their names?
His name's Michael, her name is Jenny. They're two young kids with a dream of getting on stage themselves. They've got a nice little act, apparently. And you don't even know their names. You can't even be nice. It's nice to be important, Sid, but it's more important to be nice. You taught me that. That was the first thing you taught me at the holiday camp. Be nice to the people on the way up, because you're going to meet them again on the way down. That was another famous Sid Woods quote. And look what's happened to you. You've become an arrogant, selfish tosser. There are people out there who matter. People out there keeping you in the limelight. You don't even know their fucking names.
I've got to remember my own fucking name half the time.
And whose fault is that?
But it's not mine, is it?
I'm not the one pouring the scotch for you, Sid.
No! But you're the reason I'm fucking drinking it! You! You took her from me!
You...
The only thing that mattered in my life!
You're deluded.
I saw you! I saw her coming out of your room!
You saw nothing. You saw a woman loyal to a marriage. I cuddled her. I tried to kiss her. I wanted more. What man wouldn't?
I wouldn't!
Sid, listen to what someone else is saying. Just for a few minutes before it's too late. It was you she wanted. She still does. Though God knows why. But you just let it slip. You've let everything slip. You took your eye off the ball in your home life, Sid, and you've ended up in denial. You took your finger off your pulse in this professional life, and you've ended up in debt. And you put your mouth around a bottle in self-pity, and you have ended up in the gutter. And you know what? It serves you fucking right.
So how did Tommy get here then? The bloody stork didn't bring you, did he?
prove it wasn't you, then who? And where?
It wasn't me, Sid. And there has never been a then. Even you, one night, in one of your drunken stupors, must have had sex with her. Her. Do you remember her? Julie, your wife. And the next day you woke up and probably forgot all about it and went back to ignoring her again. When was the last time that you told her that you loved me? You should always tell your loved ones you love them, Sid.
But I
no
did.
Buts, Sid. No buts. Tommy's yours. And do you know what's funny? Do you know what's really, really funny? All these years, you've been calling them a little bastard. And like every other lad out there, I bet at times he is a little bastard. But do you know what's really, really funny, Sid? He is your little bastard!
That's enough! You can't bloody talk to me like this! We have flashy fucking suits! And your ditzy girlfriend! And your punchy London agent! I made you, not them! You wouldn't even be on the fucking stage if it wasn't for me! I was the main man! The king of the castle! The one they all wanted to emulate, I was somebody!
You were the best.
Not anymore. It's all gone. Life. This business. Relationship. We've all moved on.
You never followed Sid. But you know what I say? It's never too late. Seize the day, Sid. Reinvent yourself. Make it happen again before it's too late. Because one day it will be too late, Sid. And you can do it. Because if I can do it, you can do it. I learned all I know from you.
10 minutes, Jack.
Thanks, mate. Is anyone in the bar? Remember what I said.
Jack, when you... Turn him over, quick. No, mate, don't do this to me. Come on, you bastard. Susie, go and tell the stage manager that no one can come into the gents.
Okay.
Come on, breathe, you bastard. Come on, don't do this to me. Come on, come on.
Shit.
He's gone.
What?
Susie, go and tell the stage manager to call an interval.
But we've already had the interval.
Well, tell him to get the duo to sing a couple of songs, for fuck's sake. I don't know. And Susie...
While you're there, call an ambulance.
I'm so sorry, love.
I can't believe it.
At least he died giving pleasure to those that he loved.
No, he didn't.
I'll go and get some water.
You can't be gone!
Louis, where are you, Louis? I need you.
Full circle, Jack. Cheers.
Five minutes, Louis. Three minutes, Louis.
son? Yeah. It's your dad. Yeah. Is your mother there? No. Don't. Just pass on a message. Just let her know I'm coming home tomorrow. Yeah, for good. Son, you know I love you, don't you? Yeah, I know it's soft. But you should always tell your loved ones that you love them. A friend of mine taught me that once. See ya.
Off comes the makeup, off comes the clown's disguise, the curtain's falling, the music softly dies, but I hope you're smiling as you're filing out the door, as they say in this biz, that's all there is, there isn't any more. We've shared a moment ends. I get a funny feeling we're parting now as friends. Your cheers and laughter will linger after they've torn down these dusty walls. If I had this to do again, and the moment were new again, I would spend it with you again. But now the curtain falls. Your cheer dusty walls. People say I was made for this. Not a thing would I trade for this. And to think I get paid for this.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome to the stage your top of the bill, Mr. Sid Woods!
Thank you. I have got some thank yous. Sorry to keep you on your last night, but I do have to say some thank yous on behalf of all of us, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thank you to all the lovely people at the theatre, Mr. Alan Davis and Martin and all his staff here at the theatre. Thanks to Lee and Beth and all the crew, and all the people at Gentin Casinos, believe it or not, because believe it or not, that's where this play was written, in a casino. In a casino at stupid o'clock in the morning for over 12 months it took us. So thank you to all those lovely people. And some special people we have to say some big thank yous to. First of all, we brought in the best people to help us put on the play. And we've brought our friends down from Rotherham who are the best in the business. Thank you so much to Buzz on the sound and lights. And to Damo, who's our stage manager, he's brilliant, ladies and gentlemen. And a special thanks now to these people who I've, for the past three nights and for the past fortnight, have shared every moment with, ladies and gents, and they are brilliant. So, first of all, a lady who you will see a lot more of in the future because she's an extreme talent, ladies and gentlemen. Show your appreciation for lovely Jenny Luard. Thank you. Oh, we got you some flowers. And one of my very close friends who I do pantomime with, ladies and gents, he's the real director of this piece because he kept Steve and I on the straight and narrow when we... We're deviating, ladies and gentlemen. There were lots of times where we deviated. he is indeed a brilliant talent himself. Actor, writer, comedian, and a general good egg, ladies and gents. Mr. Dave Sharp. Thank you very much indeed. I'll get into trouble if we don't thank our families. I got a special, say a special, she's not here, but I got to say a special thanks to Lisa and the boys because they've put up with a lot over the past 12 months. I know Steve wants to thank his mum and dad and his family. But, and then a big thanks to all of you for supporting us and believing that we could do it, ladies and gents, and we did it. And my unreserved thanks, one last time, ladies and gentlemen, to my friend, my brother, my co-writer. He is an incredible talent. We've shared laughter, tears, no arguments in the process of doing this, unbelievably. But he is incredible, and he has proved those people who said he wouldn't be able to do this wrong. Steve Laister, ladies and gentlemen.
Nearly. Thank you so much. It's very, very kind of you. It did start in September 2012 when Dean and I went on holiday to Spain for a Jolly Boys. Well, it's not really Jolly Boys because I don't drink, but... He had the Jolly Boys drinking. And we went our way to Spain. I just watched him drink. And we went over with the intention of writing a sitcom. The day before, he said, geese. Geese. That's how he speaks, for those people who don't know. I've had an idea whilst I was in the bath. And I think we should write a play. I said, all right. And we went away to Spain to write a play. It rained. It was the worst weather Spain had had for 100 years, so we had plenty of time to do it. We got a gig in a karaoke bar when we ran out of money. And we got 50 euros each for 4 hours. But it helped us continue the writing. And then, like Dean said, two or three nights a week for the last 52 weeks, we've been up late writing this and living the dream. And it was an idea that Dean had, But wow, what an actor. It's a privilege working alongside these three people. But we have got to get out of the clubs that we're doing, Dean. We're so proud. This is, you know, this is the first time we've ever written a serious play, a black comedy. It's our first venture into writing. We've never, ever done it before. These guys have done panto, and they're three of the top panto actors in the country. But, well Dave, oh yes you are. But seriously, it's been an honour working alongside these three professionals in this new road. All that I'm really excited about for Dean and I is that the writing of the play works. I mean, that's the best thing that could ever happen to us. We wrote something that is poignant, hopefully made you think about it, see two sides to every single story. And if you do love someone, when you go home, just go and tell them that you love them. That's really important. But for me, it's been an honour working alongside you, mate. The writing, we've been on the casino floor laughing, belly laughing. Unfortunately, I did miss out one or two lines tonight, which were funny as well. But Dean, it's an honour being your best friend. And I'm very proud to be that. Thank you. If anybody wants to stay behind and help us strike the set, we need to get it downstairs in the basement within 25 minutes. So God bless you. Thank you very much. The bar is still open, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you in the bar in 5 minutes. Thank you.